director of Green Mountain Academy for Lifelong Learning. Those of you not familiar with the Academy, we are a small not-for-profit organization based here in Manchester, and we offer courses in a wide range of topics, and tonight's lecture is part of our Hot Topic series. Before I introduce our speaker, I would like to thank the First Congregational Church for the use of this space, and GNAT-TV for providing video production and TV broadcasts of our programs to the community. Our speaker tonight is Matthew Dickinson. He is a professor of political science at Middlebury College. He previously taught at Harvard University, where he also received his PhD, working under the supervision of presidential scholar Richard Neustadt, and was a fellow in the governmental studies program at the Brookings Institution. He is an author and also published numerous articles on the presidency, Congress, presidential decision-making, and presidential advisors. Please join me in welcoming Matthew Dickinson.
Thank you, Gloria. I'm going to try to start speaking without a microphone, and if you have problems hearing me, raise your hand and we'll switch over to the microphone. I tend to talk very loudly. My students typically don't have a problem. They fall asleep instantly. I don't keep them awake, but we'll see how it goes today. I'm a little disconcerted. I didn't know we were going to have a television program here, and this is worrisome because I'm going to make a prediction about the 2012 presidential election. Usually I can deny the prediction when it goes wrong, as it often does. I'm going to have problems denying it here. What I want to do today is talk for roughly 45 minutes about the state of the race and what I think political scientists can tell us. Maybe they won't tell us anything tonight, unless this goes on. There we go. What political scientists can tell you that the media won't or the media can't about the election. And I'm going to end with a prediction. It might not be a very satisfactory prediction, but I'll go about 45 minutes, and then the most enjoyable thing for me, every 3 years I toil, well, for 3 years period, I toil in obscurity. And then every fourth year they trot me out, and I go around the state making multiple talks. So I'm now out of the cobwebs. You know, if it's Thursday, I must be in Manchester. This is exciting for me. This is what I do. I write about the presidency. I lecture about the presidency, including presidential elections. So this is a very exciting election for me. Also, I don't have a stake in the outcome. I should tell you up front, I don't vote. I don't recommend that strategy for you. I urge all of you to vote. But I don't. I have no dog in this fight. The only time I vote is for my wife, who's in the back. She runs for a local office in Ripton, but even then I don't tell her who I vote for. So I'm going to try to give you the no partisan perspective here. Am I walking out of your camera?
A little bit. Yeah.
There's a reason for that as well. All right, for the next 67 days, or roughly that amount, you are going to be inundated with campaign advertisements, media stories, pundits. For those of you who are inane enough to watch cable TV, I'm sure you're all watching Fox News. Yes?
No.
MSNBC?
Yeah.
CNN? And they are going to tell you all sorts of things about the race. Which candidate is better to have a beer with? Or as we heard in today's Washington Post, who's more likely to be a better dinner companion? They're going to talk about the impact of fundraising, campaign advertising, candidate gaffes. And the interesting thing is almost none of these are consequential for the outcome of a presidential race. At least this is what I'm going to argue today. Really, if you want to know why presidential races turn out the way they do, you really only need to know maybe two or three things about the election. In fact, the most important thing to know, if I met you on the street, I could, with one question, with 90% accuracy, determine for whom you will vote in 2012. What's the question? What's that? It's pretty darn important. No? Who are you voting for? Actually, I hate when we have smart people in the audience. Yeah, that's right. And in fact, when Nate Silver trots out his final prediction, Nate Silver, the New York Times columnist, some of you read him, that's actually what he does. He basically, his fancy model, he throws it out the window, and he just looks at polling that says, who are you going to vote for? And he adds up all the polls, and he makes his prediction. It's tremendously accurate. I'm doing something more ambitious than what Nate Silver is going to do. And the one question I ask you is, do you consider yourself a Democrat, a Republican, or something else? And depending on your answer to that, I can tell you with 90% accuracy who you're going to vote for, because partisan identification is a shorthand cue for all sorts of things that are important in choosing the president. It is encapsulates your view towards the basic issues that drive presidential elections. Do you believe in an active government or a smaller government? Do you believe in an aggressive foreign policy, minimal foreign policy? Do you support health care or not? I don't need to ask you any of those questions. I just need to know whether you consider yourself a Democrat, a Republican, or an independent. Now, some of you are going to say, oh, I'm a registered independent. So that doesn't tell you anything. But the reality is most independents aren't pure independents at all. They actually lean one way or the other and consistently vote one way or the other. So if you ask yourself, in your heart of hearts, am I a true independent? Most of you are not. Most of you have political leanings. All right. So why do we care about this? Nate Silver wants to predict the winner because Nate Silver's writing a column. He's getting paid a lot of money, a little bit more money than I'm getting paid. And it draws readers in if he seems to have some wisdom that other people don't. So the extent to which we're willing to read Nate Silver's column depends on him getting it right, which is why in the end he fudges and just sort of cheats. Political scientists have a more noble cause. We don't really care about the outcome of a presidential election. We don't even care about whether we get it right, although we sort of care. We are political scientists, emphasis on the science. When I went into this field, I remember my father laughing at me, saying, it's an oxymoron, it's like military intelligence. There is no science in the study of politics. And for the most part, I think that's right. If you study comparative politics or international relations or political theory, it's mostly normative, it's dressed up history. I always kid my colleagues in the political science department at Harvard and Middlebury that the only true study of politics that be considered a science is the study of American politics, which I happen to specialize in. And within the study of American politics, the most scientific enterprise is election forecasting. We actually know quite a bit about how people vote and why they vote that way. And I'm going to trot out some of the evidence of that. Why do we care then? We care because any science that stakes a claim to being a true science must be able to predict events, right? When we shoot a satellite into the orbit, we are basing our assumptions about where that satellite is going to end up and not fall back to Earth on the science of physics, right? Political scientists dream of the same type. We're not quite there with physics yet, but we're dreaming with the same type of accuracy. And I would argue elections are the closest we come. So why we are interested in forecasting election outcomes is not so much that we want to boast about how smart we are. I'll leave that to Nate Silver. It's to test our understanding of the elections. Do we understand elections as much as we claim to? So let me give you some evidence, irrefutable proof that the study of elections is a science. You stay with me here, okay? Is political science truly a science? Can we predict political outcomes? In 2004, oops, I don't want that. 2004, note all these forecasts are made before Labor Day. That is, most of them were made in 2004, about a week before where we are now. What we have is the forecaster's name. They all have different variations of a prediction model. Here's the actual winner, but we don't really care about the winner. What we're really interested in is, can we predict the percent of the two-party vote? We only focus on two major parties. We don't worry about third parties. So these percentages are the two-party votes. And these were the predictions of the share of the two-party vote in 2004. Who was running in 2004? Anybody remember?
Bush.
John Kerry, right? Every one of them predicted Bush except this poor guy. He predicted Kerry, but we count his prediction as accurate because in the end, actual Bush vote was 51.2%. That's about, if you can do the math, about a little over 1.2% off from his prediction. So you got to give us a fudge factor. Most of these predictions are within a percentage to a percentage and a half. It's called the margin of error, statistical error. And we figure if we get it within, it's good enough for government work, if we can get it within a percentage or so. So look at this. This is amazing. Before Labor Day, before the Swift boat ads, before the debates, before John Kerry went windsurfing, before any of those events that the media said was important, we already knew what the share of the two-party vote was going to be. The average prediction, if you added all these together, average the individual models, 52.8%, actually 51, so we're up by 1.6%. That's pretty impressive. Are you as impressed as I am? I get teary-eyed every time I put that up. But wait, there's more. It gets better. We get more scientific. We get more models. Here's 2008. Who ran in 2008? Barack Obama, right? And John McCain. All right, same thing. These are the, actually this time I give you the actual dates of the forecasts. One of them as early as January 15th. I don't actually put much stock in that, but I throw it up there. That was actually right after the New Hampshire primary. This guy claims he can predict based on the New Hampshire primary. How people are going to do it. I throw that one out there, but I put it in here. Once again, the only one who got it wrong was this guy, James Campbell. He actually predicted, this is the two-party share of the vote. I say Democratic because some of these are out before we knew Obama was the nominee. So they're just basically predicting how the Democratic candidate, whether it was Hillary Clinton or Barack Obama, was going to do here. And again, every one of them has got Obama winning, ranging from a low of 50.1 all the way up to some that were admittedly wrong, 58%. That was far too optimistic of 55. You throw those out. But if you add them all together, 52.4%, the actual Obama share of the two-party vote, 53.7. Once again, we're off by about 1.3%. Again, look at the times we're making these. These are in July, August. These are all Labor Day. Only a couple come afterwards. And they don't. The one most recent one, October 10th, is actually one of the ones that really hit, and we'll talk about that. So this wasn't just the shot in the dark. In 2004, we did it again. In 2008, pretty darn impressive, huh? How do we do this? Magic? My students ask that. I tell them I'm a genius. But none of them believe that, because they've had me in class long enough to realize that's not true. It has to do with that question I asked you about why individuals vote the way they do. Most of you are not blank slates, that you come to an election with your mind free of any predispositions or inclinations. You actually have an inclination captured in that vote, and that explains almost all of your vote decision. But there's still some uncertainty among some of you. Some of you are strong partisans, some of you are marginal partisans. And that uncertainty is what really we're trying to capture in our forecast models. And we think that uncertainty is driven by something that I call the electoral fundamentals. By the way, you're wondering why my name wasn't up there. I don't do my own forecast model. I sort of cheat. I stand on the shoulders of other people. But I make my prediction. And September 18th, oops, I actually, in an audience like this, made my prediction. And I can trot it out here because I was pretty right. The one thing I got wrong, I actually underestimated Obama's, I thought race was going to play a bigger role. I thought the polls were overstating the support for him as the first African-American. So I thought maybe the so-called, a lot of you heard about the Bradley effect, named after an African-American who ran for elected office in California. The poll suggested he was going to win. He ended up not winning, and a lot of people said people were lying to the pollsters because they didn't want to admit they were going to vote against the black guy. And so a lot of us worried that was going to happen to Barack Obama. The polls were overstating. Turned out it didn't happen at all. I can talk about issues of race later. So I underestimated Obama's, but I still got it right. So I feel proud, and I'm willing to put it up there. All right, election fundamentals. Partisan affiliation serves as a primary voting cue. But then the additional variable, the most important thing, is what I call reality. When you go to vote in 2012, you take an assessment of the state of the nation. And in most elections, that assessment is driven primarily about the economy, economic measures. Sometimes we're in the middle of a war, as in 1968 or in 1952, Korean War, Vietnam War. War will play in, and I'll show you how that plays out in some models. But most of us are making an assessment. We're evaluating the president's handling of the economy. Now, that assessment is probably based on a misleading belief that the president actually can handle the economy, but be that as it may, he is the individual that we view as most responsible for the state of the nation, and so, fair or not, we give him credit for or blame him for the state of the economy. So what we do, all those models you saw, they create some measure of reality, whether it's unemployment, growth in GDP, gross domestic product, changes in disposable income, how much money, spending money you have in your wallet. And we go back in history, dating most of our models go back to 1952 or 1948, the so-called modern presidency, and we correlate those measures of reality with how people actually voted. And from that, we construct a model, a forecast model, that we then use to predict what's going to happen in 2012. So there's a couple of assumptions here. One is that people in 2012 behaved pretty much as they have behaved in all previous elections. If somehow people change their voting calculus, our models are wrong. Right? So keep that in mind. The second thing some models do is they add in a couple of additional variables. And there's actually some dispute among political scientists. I won't get into it. So one thing we want to know is how long have you been in office, or your party's been in control of the presidency? Because we know at a certain point, you begin to be viewed as a party that's time has run its course. Generally, after three terms, you begin to lose support among voters, all other things being equal. And it's the grass is greener. They begin to think about what the other party might bring. So we want to know how long you've been a party. And then some people cheat, at least political scientists consider it cheating. They look at presidential approval. You know, all sorts of pollsters out there ask on a regular basis, do you approve or disapprove of the job the president is doing? Gallup started that back with Roosevelt. Now lots of people do. So we factor those in. That's it. That's all we need to know. Are you a Democrat or Republican? What's the state of reality? And maybe some models, how long has your party been in office, and what's your approval rating? From that, we can construct a prediction based on how Barack Obama is going to do in 2012. That's all we need to know. All that other stuff is peripheral. Doesn't matter. I'm exaggerating. I'm exaggerating to make a point, but it's almost true. All right, there's a couple of assumptions here. One is that voters are rational. They vote their preference. They don't do irrational things and say, oh, the economy really is going horribly. I'm going to reward the president by giving him another 4 years. Right? And by the way, most people, when they think about the economy, they don't think about their own circumstances. They think about the nation's are going in the right direction or not. And second, we assume voters can differentiate where candidates stand on these broad issues, right? So it wouldn't do us much good if we're going to blame the incumbent and we thought, for some reason, Mitt Romney was the incumbent. Turns out, if you do polling about what voters know about the two candidates' policy stances, they know almost nothing. But they can tell who the Republican and who the Democrat is. And they can tell who the incumbent is and who the challenger is. And based on those two things, they can make a pretty logical choice on who's closer to them on their preferences, given that they are a Republican or a Democrat. So a lot of simplifying assumptions based on here, but I don't think they're oversimplifications. I think if you think about it, it makes a lot of sense, right? All right, wonderful. So I just proved to you that political science is a science. I'm going to jump to the prediction, and we'll wrap up early. Any questions? Remember, I'm claiming I'm going to tell you this, but I'm not looking at anything about tactics or strategy, all the stuff you read about, the horse race. I'm ignoring it. Fundraising, story came out today, Obama's outraised Romney. I've been teaching all day, I'm completely fried. Fundraising, doesn't matter. I basically think it's going to cancel each other out. Candidate qualities, we know that, say what you will about Barack Obama's policies, people like him. They like him more than Mitt Romney. And the old beer test, which is kind of a bad question to ask about Mitt Romney since he doesn't drink. But most people would rather have a beer with Barack Obama. Most people would rather have dinner with Barack Obama. Doesn't matter. Debates. We got three debates coming up beginning October 3rd. I don't care about them. I'll show you some data. Not going to switch anybody's minds unless somebody just falls off the stage. Or, in fact, the whole notion of candidate gaffes, way overblown. I'll talk a little bit about what we know about candidate gaffes. Ads, remember those Swift Boat ads? Willie Horton ad way back in 1988 that doomed Michael Dukakis? Vastly overstated. Almost no impact on the race whatsoever. Right? Black swan events. Everybody know what a black swan event is? Black swan event, how many times have you seen a black swan? That's what a black swan event is, right? They are inherently unpredictable. You can't predict when a black swan is going to show up. So we don't worry about them. That's not to say if a nuclear war exchange takes place between North Korea and South Korea or something, that's not going to affect the election. It is. But by definition, science cannot predict unpredictable events. So I don't worry about black swan events. But don't you come knocking on my door if a black swan event happens and throws the election forecast off. That's not my fault. Right? That doesn't mean my model is wrong. Endorsements. We're going to get celebrity endorsements right and left. The Oprah endorsements, always big. Makes no difference. That's what I'm claiming here. I'm basically discounting everything the media is going to cover the next 67 days, the campaign. You guys are shaking your head. Nobody believes this. And yet, statistics don't lie, do they? Let me make one thing clear here. Campaigns do matter. They matter in ways that are crucial to the outcome of presidential elections, and they will be particularly crucial to the outcome of 2012. But there's a reason why I'm going to discount them when I'm making a forecast, and I'll try to explain this. But what happened in 2000? Everybody remember the election of 2000? Most of us remember it because of Florida.
Yeah.
Hanging chads, the Supreme Court intervening to stop recounting of the ballots and supposedly throwing the election to Bush or not, depending on whether you're a Republican or a Democrat. And I can poll you and I can tell you if you think the Supreme Court threw that election to George Bush, you're a Democrat. If you don't, you're a Republican. It's another indication of partisan affiliation and how it serves as a prism. Notice, in 2000, Al Gore, Bill Clinton's vice president, running at a time of, remember this? We had a budget surplus. Do you remember that? Most of you don't remember that. It's a budget surplus, the last surplus we have had and probably will have in your lifetime or my lifetime, right? Peace, prosperity, we weren't at war. We had some terrorism issue, but this was pre 9/11. Al Gore should have won this in a walk. And in fact, all our forecast models had him winning, a couple of them had him winning 60% of the vote. That's a landslide. I'm not dealing with the Electoral College here. I will in a second. This is how far off from what he actually got. The actual Gore share was 50.2%. Where we were predicting 56 on average. You can see some of these were 10 percentage points off. I could have done better just blindfolded throwing darts and gotten within closer than 10%. I mean, we were way off. There's fewer models then, but the point is political scientists totally whiffed on 2000. I mean, we got the guy right. Al Gore won the popular vote. We tend to forget that, right? The George Bush won the Electoral College vote but lost the popular vote. So technically, we were right. But we really weren't right. We were way off, way optimistic. So what happened? Whenever I make this argument, and I show this data, the audience always says, your model was wrong. That's why. You can't forecast it. But I don't give up so easily. There's two explanations. The models were wrong, or Gore ran a lousy campaign. Which explanation do you think I bought? I think Gore ran a lousy campaign, and this is the point I want to drive home about campaigns and why campaigns matter. When we emphasize the fundamentals, we are making an assumption. We are assuming that both candidates, looking at reality, run equally effective campaigns. By that, I mean you cannot change reality. There is no evidence, contrary to what you might believe, that candidates can basically create misperceptions about reality for most voters. If Al Gore, or look at 2012, if Barack Obama was running for president and he says, hey, the economy's turned around on my watch, deficit's gotten smaller, we're well on our way to prosperity, you're not going to believe him because you have 100 different information sources that are telling you the opposite. And if they weren't, Mitt Romney would be. So our assumption is both candidates take that reality, they start with their base, and they are equally effective at framing that reality in ways that help their candidacy. And so when we make our forecast models, we just do away with the campaigns. We get right to the chase. Because what are the campaigns doing? They're basically dealing with the fundamentals. They're trying to frame that. And we generally don't see much difference between the quality of those candidacies. So the argument we're making in 2000 is Al Gore ran a lousy campaign. Al Gore, if you remember, ran a campaign that proposed all sorts of new policy initiatives. He was going to spend more on education. Entitlement programs, he was talking about putting some of the entitlement money in a lockbox. Never going to spend that, remember that? That was the wrong campaign to run. When you're running on peace and prosperity, all he had to say was one big bumper sticker. I'm Bill Clinton, but I'll keep my pants zipped. Right? I'll continue prosperity, and you won't have any of that other, those other issues. Excuse me for talking about that. But he didn't. So we think he ran a lousy campaign. He won, but he should have won by a lot more. So the assumption underlying my forecast model and all the other ones is that the campaigns matter, but typically we don't notice or don't need to take into account because both candidacies are candidates are running equally. All right? So campaigns matter. If you are somebody who's going to be advantaged, let's say you're the incumbent president, the economy's sailing along, you run on the fundamentals if they favor you. You emphasize the economy. Ronald Reagan, it's morning in America, right? You just ignore your opponent. If you're John McCain, you're running in 2008 when your party, on your party's watch, the economy's gone to hell in a handbasket with the fiscal crisis, the financial crisis, the collapse of the housing market. You don't want to run on the economy. You have no choice, but you try to shift the debate onto more favorable ground. My opponent is inexperienced. I am experienced. I was shot down, captured, served 8 years as a prisoner of war, or whatever it was. You don't want that guy in charge. You try to shift the debate, right? And that's what John McCain didn't do very well in 2008, but I would argue it wouldn't have mattered. Sometimes the fundamentals are so strong, you can't run against them. You basically are, it's a losing year for you, right? So Gore didn't run on the dominant strategy of accentuating the fundamentals. He ran on policy proposals dealing with education and entitlements, not the economy. He squandered the fundamentals. So our models assume you make the right choices here. All right, so where do we stand in 2012? Economy's not good. But the thing that a lot of people underestimate, it's not as bad as you might think historically. If you go back to Jimmy Carter, that's where the term stagflation came from, right? In 1980, the economy was actually far worse than it is now because you had this combination of inflation and unemployment. If we look historically at indicators of economic performance, it basically says Obama is going to get about 50% of the vote looking only on the economy, give or take a few, right? His approval ratings, he's basically been at about 47 approval, 48, 49 disapproval for several months. Mediocre, right? War, we are at war, but it's nothing like Vietnam or the Korean War. We had about 4,000 casualties. Support for Afghanistan is dropping, but it's not a war-driven campaign. It's really an economic campaign. Most of us have sort of put that war out of our minds. He is a first-term incumbent. What does that mean? We don't have fatigue of Democrats yet. They've only been in power 4 years, and it turns out this is an important component of his campaign message. If you saw him in the Democratic Convention, what did he say? I've only had one term to turn this around. I inherited this mess. Give me another term. And that actually resonates with a lot of voters. They're not ready to switch. Whereas John McCain was running after 4 years of George Bush. Right? Sorry, 8 years of George Bush. Thank you for the correction. All right, so the fundamentals suggest at the outset that this is going to be very close. I'm sort of tipping my hand here. Here's where the race actually stands. What I have here is in blue. This is the polling trend of Barack Obama dating back to the first of the year. The red is Mitt Romney. Each of these dots is an individual poll. So what we've basically done here is just take the average of those polls. So focusing on here, what do we see? Very close race, but at no point has Mitt Romney since, this is basically when he clinched the nomination, since then has he been above in the aggregate polls of Barack Obama. By the way, this gap looks bigger than it is. We're basically talking 1 to 2 percentage points through this entire period. Now you notice this big increase here? It's gone up to 3 to 4 percentage points. Don't get excited about that. That is the convention bump. people were paying a lot of attention for coming in there, and now they're being asked by a pollster who you're going to vote for, and they remember all those wonderful things that people said about the president, Michelle Obama, and all those other people. That's going to reside, probably drop back down. In fact, a poll today from the Washington Post suggested among likely voters it had gone back to a dip. Now you say, well, and some of us learned this for the first time in 2000, we actually don't elect presidents in this country based on the popular vote. We elect them on the Electoral College vote. And don't I read that Barack Obama is ahead in most of the states, and that if you, you know, based on polling, he's got 221 Electoral College votes. Romney only has 191, right? This is based on strong states. These are the number of states, and these are the Electoral College votes. Strong states, likely states, and leaning states. Looks like he's ahead. You need 270 to win, right? So he's in good shape in the Electoral College. There's probably 10 battleground states. This is where, because of the nature of the way we choose presidents, most of the election action is going to take place. And he's ahead in every one of those states. These are the size of the Electoral College votes in each of these states. And these are the polling averages. These are now about a week old. I gave a talk earlier. I wasn't able to update these. Notice Romney's only ahead in one state, North Carolina. So this looks like a slam dunk. What's the odds that Mitt Romney can flip all these states? Well, actually, the odds are better than you might think. And the problem a lot of pundits make when they present these individual states is they treat them as if they are independent actions. So what happens in New Hampshire has nothing to do with what happens in North Carolina, which has nothing to do with what happens in Ohio. That's actually not true. Think of these states as boats. They all are affected by a rising tide of support for either candidate. So if Mitt Romney, for some reason, say a great debate performance, is able to draw an additional 1 to 2% support among, say, the undecided voters, we have basically 10 to 15%, he will pull ahead of Obama in 5 of the 9 battleground states that I just showed. And he will take the lead in the Electoral College. So that Electoral College lead is not nearly as substantial as you might think just by looking at the pundits' assignment of the states. It's very fluid, right? All right, this I always get. Well, how can you depend on the polls? What if the polls are wrong? We all know Dewey defeated Truman, right? Polls can be wrong. The great benefit of doing these talks now as opposed to 1948 is now we have 30 or 40 polls, so the errors tend to cancel out. In 1948, they had the Gallup poll, and that was it. And if they got it wrong, we all got it wrong. One thing you got to look at, registered voters versus likely voters. In 2008, they were giving us different pictures as of October, a week before the election. Obama, among registered voters, had a very comfortable 8% lead, 50 to 42. Among likely voters, the lead shrunk a little bit, and then another likely voters, it was down to 5%. Generally speaking, likely voter models, Republicans do better. By likely voters, the pollsters call up and they try to ascertain whether you are likely to vote. They have a series of questions. Most pollsters right now are not using likely voter models. All they're doing is sampling registered voters. If you're on the voting list and you're affiliated with a party, they'll call you up. But as we get closer to the election, they're going to switch to likely voters. That's going to benefit Mitt Romney, the Republican. Republicans always are advantaged when we switch from registered voters to likely voters. Why is that? Because, basically, Democrats tend to do better among lower income, less educated voters. And those are also the criteria that indicate whether you're going to vote or not. The lower your income, the lower your education, the less likely you are going to vote. So when we move to registered voter list to likely voter list, we lose Democrats. And suddenly Romney's going to jump up. We're beginning to see that. Give you an example. Today's Washington Post ABC poll among registered voters, Obama's up 6 percentage points, a big post-convention bump. At the same time, they sampled likely voters, dead heat. Right? So we're going to see this race tighten as we switch. All right, what other factors might influence the outcome? I'm getting to the prediction. You still with me? Give me a couple more minutes. Change in the economic fundamentals, the vice presidential pick, debates, candidate gaffes, campaign ads, turnout enthusiasm, black swan event. I dismissed all of these. But now I'm going to bring them all back into play. And the only way these matter is if there's a huge differential And even then, they're going to make a very small impact on the popular vote. But guess what? In a 50-50 election, anything can make the difference, right? So I'm going to sort of contradict myself here, but bear with me. So let's I'll run you through the likelihood of any of these things happening. First of all, we're assuming the economy right now is going to remain pretty much the same, sluggish, unemployment about 8%. That is, our opinion of the economy is pretty well baked in, and we've calculated that into whether we support Obama or not. But if something dramatic happens, as it did in 2008, say Greece, the economy collapses, the euro goes down, and suddenly Europe sneezes and we catch the economic flu. That could hurt Obama, right? In 2008, what I've done here, this is ground zero, the date of the financial collapse, when the media started focusing on it. And these are McCain's support in blue. This is the stock market, Standard & Poor's 500 in green. As the stock market went down 2 days, 4 days, 6 days, 8 days, McCain's support went down. That sort of reinforced the prevailing assumption there that the economy was the fault of the Republicans. They were getting the blame. But if something similar happened, one of these black swan economic events, our forecasts are off. Vice presidential pick. Remember Paul Ryan?
Yeah.
Right? Vice president, guy who ran the sub-three-hour marathon. Pretty impressive. First marathon. My wife didn't do better than 3 hours in her marathon. Did you, Allison? Pretty darn close. But she did beat his actual time, which was more than 4 hours, right? Liar, liar, pants on fire. Turns out that pick has resonated deeply among Republicans, hasn't done much among independents. Didn't really boost the way Sarah Palin boosted John McCain initially. In 2008, we tend to forget this, but when Sarah Palin gave her convention speech, electrifying. Republicans actually shot ahead for the only time in the general election campaign based on Sarah Palin. I say that again. Republicans shot ahead in 2008 based on Sarah Palin. Paul Ryan is no Sarah Palin, right? The only thing he has done is maybe made Wisconsin more competitive. Wisconsin, I didn't think was going to be a battleground state. Now it is neck and neck. So in a tight electoral college race, the Ryan pick could be decisive, but it hasn't changed the overlying dynamics. How about the debates? October 3rd, we all remember those debates, dating back to the first televised debate between John Kennedy and Richard Nixon. Kennedy was tanned, rested. Remember, some of you saw that debate?
Yes.
Richard Nixon was coming off an extended air trip. He was fighting the flu. His makeup people were horrible. He looked ghastly. Rumor has it that as a result of that, he lost that debate and lost the election. The funny thing is we have no evidence that's true, because we weren't polling well. But that's sort of the story that we like to tell. Remember in 1976, Gerald Ford was debating Jimmy Carter. Gerald Ford liberated Poland. A lot of us don't remember that. But he was basically trying to say the Poles are courageous people. They're people who will never bow down to the yoke of communism. But he basically came out saying, the Poles are free. Well, they weren't. They were behind the Iron Curtain. They were ruled by a communist puppet government. The interesting thing was, if you surveyed people, and we actually did right after the debate, nobody thought that was a gaffe. It wasn't until the media picked up on it, partly because the Carter people were saying, did you see what he said? That it became a gaffe. 1980, there was one debate, very late. It was the debate where Jimmy Carter said, you know, I was talking to my daughter Amy, and she said the most important problem in the world is nuclear weapons. And Reagan was viewed, we kind of think of Reagan now as sort of this affable, congenial man. At the time, we were terrified of him. We thought this guy was a cowboy who was likely to set us off in a nuclear war. He did well enough in that debate to allay those fears, and right after the debate, his support surged. What we don't remember is he actually was leading before the debate. So the debate didn't actually turn the election so much as it cemented the fundamentals. All the way of saying, it's not clear to me these debates were decisive. If we look in 2008, CBS Knowledge Network showed so-called independents, undecided voters, the second debate between McCain and 40% identified Obama as tonight's winner, 26% John McCain, 34% said it was a draw, You think Obama got a huge boost among the undecided voters, but you would be wrong. 72% of the uncommitted voters remained uncommitted, 15% committed to Obama, 12% to McCain. Given the margin of error, it didn't change the election at all. And that's generally what we find when we very carefully study the effect of debates. They do not have a huge impact. And here's why. How many saw the Obama-McCain debates, any of them? Did it change your mind? Raise your hand regarding who you were going to vote.
No.
Not a hand went up. And that's generally what we find. People tend to look at those debates through their pre-existing partisan affiliation. I hate to beat a dead horse, but that's why I want to know what your partisanship is. It's going to tell me how you react to all these other things, right? All right, endorsements. Remember Colin Powell?
Yeah.
Republican Secretary of State coming out and endorsing Barack Obama, African-American, endorsing another African-American. It had a marginal impact. This was a highly publicized endorsement. Did it make you more likely to support Obama? Less than 19% said more likely, 4% less likely, 77% it made no difference. Keep in mind, of these 19%, we don't know how many were going to vote for Obama anyhow. So it's not telling me it changed votes. For most people, it made no difference in how they were going to vote. Endorsements, even Oprah. I don't think Oprah's going to swing the election this time around. So the media is going to pay a lot of attention to the endorsements, which do matter in the nomination phase, but not in the general election. How about the media? One of the things John McCain complained about, and we're hearing a bit of this, is the media is biased. That at the national level, reporters who work for the major television stations and the major print media outlets are a bunch of tree-hugging, eco-terrorist, communist sympathizing, limousine-driving, latte-sipping liberals. And the funny thing is, if you ask them on an individual level what their partisan affiliation is, they are. We know, going all the way back to the 1970s, that most correspondents, journalists, are liberal, far more liberal than the average American. What we don't believe, however, is that liberalism biases their news reports. In fact, if there is a bias, it tends to be a structural bias. Everybody always says, but Professor Dickinson, look at this data. This is from the Pew report. They went and coded news stories, both televised and print, for detection of tone. And generally speaking, they found that this blue is negative. John McCain got much more negative press than Barack Obama. Barack Obama got mostly neutral, but a little more positive, whereas McCain got very little positive. Isn't that evidence of bias? And my response is, yes, but it probably reflects a different kind of bias, bias that affects all news media almost equally, a structural bias. And that bias is what? What is distinctive about American news media? It's profit-driven. In particularly in an era of shrinking viewership, they have to do everything they can do to attract an audience. You maintain an audience, you can sell higher advertising rates, you can make money. What does that mean? It means they focus on, the alternative explanation here is they didn't like Obama because he was a Democrat. They liked him because he was more newsworthy. He was new. McCain was McSame. He had already run for president in 2000, right? This was the historic story. This was the first African American, right? So partly I think this is, I'm not saying they're not biased, they probably are, but the bias reflects a more deep-seated drive, I think, for, and the other thing we have to keep in mind is, as a lot of people pointed out, no wonder he got better coverage. He was running a better campaign, right? He was ahead in the polls. All along the way of saying, I don't have the data yet, it won't come out until late October, but my guess is if we look at this data in 2012, the negative coverage of Obama's probably gone up. I'm not saying it's going to be more than the positive coverage, but he is no longer newsworthy. He's an incumbent. He's saddled with a record that he's got to defend. So I'm going to gently disagree with my colleagues who suggest this indicates that there's a liberal news media. Keep in mind also that the news media has fractured into lots of different smaller outlets that are really catering to a particular ideological perspective. That's why a lot of you watch Fox, because a lot of you are goose-stepping neo-Nazi, like Bible-toting, bitter, gun-holding fascist, right? So you can watch Fox. So that's not going to change your viewpoint very much either. All right, campaign ads. Remember that Swift vote ad that effectively did John Kerry in? John Kerry was running as a war hero. A bunch of Swift vote veterans came out, ran three ads against him. They ran initially in three states, battleground states. Unfortunately, I don't have data from those battleground states. It is possible the Swift vote ad in the short term hurt Kerry, but in the long term, it basically was, its effects dissipated. In fact, this is what we see. So here's, John Kerry is at 45%. I don't know if you can see this. This is 51% for George Bush. This is at the end of July. The Swift vote ads run basically here through August. There's three different series. Not much impact on Gallup. Here is the convention. The Bush administration, the Bush people get their convention bounce. But then look at Kerry comes all the way back, and he's basically where he was relative to Bush before the Swift vote ads. In fact, we've measured the independent impact of campaign ads, and do you know how long an individual can remember the particulars of a campaign ad? 2 weeks. We show them an ad, quiz them about it, we come back 2 weeks later and say, you remember that Swift vote ad? No, they don't. It's hard to believe, but they just don't remember the particulars. The other thing to keep in mind is that Swift vote ad is going to be one of hundreds of ads. Already, you can't turn on the TV without seeing an ad. I've seen Karl Rove's Crossroad ads a dozen times just tonight. Well, last night, I should have said. Right, so you're going to, the impact of ads, if they are effective, they have to be a particularly memorable ad, and it probably has to run in the last 2 weeks. That's what our data shows. So we can dismiss those. What about candidate qualities? I haven't said anything about candidate qualities. Don't we vote for the person in this country? What I've done here is every election, the National Election Survey asks people to list the five qualities or characteristics associated with the candidate. So, you know, Obama, socialist, inexperienced, lacks principles,
Muslim, right?
Mitt Romney. Shifty, rich,
stupid.
Right? And what I've done here is you construct an index. Basically, I add all the positive references together for each candidate back to 1952. Black is Democratic candidate. Blue is Republican. I add all the negative characteristics and I subtract them. So if you're above the zero line, you had more positive references. If you're below it, you have more negative references. Let's look at a couple of these. Who's this guy right here who had a ton of negative references? That's Ronald Reagan. Nobody liked Ronald Reagan. They ever described him as cowboy, warmonger, right? Extremist actor, right? I don't know if I coded actor as positive. Depends on his movie. Bedtime for Bonzo, that's a negative, right? Who did he run against? Look at this guy, a saint. Who was that?
Jimmy Carter,
Baptist priest. Preacher, I mean. Sure, he lusted after women, but he never acted on it. He admitted it, right? That's a point in his favor. What happened in 1980? Reagan, the most disliked candidate they have in this entire, easily wins over Jimmy Carter, the best liked candidate. Jump here, who's this guy? 1996, that's Clinton. Ed Clinton never saw, not only did he lust after women, but he took action on it, right? He's the guy who led us into an impeachment scandal all because of, it depends on what is, right? All that salacious activity. Nobody liked him, and he runs against the guy who, you know, we didn't love him like Eisenhower. He certainly was a war veteran, served his country, Bob Dole. What happened there? Got trounced. The guy we hated won. Listen. All other things being equal, you want to be liked rather than disliked. I think you'd rather be Barack Obama than Mitt Romney right now, but all other things aren't equal. Candidate qualities play a very small role in an election. There is no strong correlation between our views towards a candidate and whether we voted for them or not in this sequence. 2012, close election, fine. Maybe the fact that I'd rather have a beer and dinner with Barack Obama might sway enough voters at the margins to win. But that's not where I'm going to start with my explanation. That's where I'm going to end. Gaffes. We all know the gaffes. The media plays them over and over, and they claim these are instrumental in changing votes. Remember Obama? You didn't build that? Socialist. He thinks the government was responsible for all the business's success. When we all know it was the bootstraps, individuals pulling themselves up. Do you believe that? Raise your hand if you think that accurately characterizes a description of how business is built. I'm asking that question. Do you agree with Obama that no one succeeds in this country without help of other peoples, including government? Yeah! So you don't buy that as a criticism. Again, partisan affiliation is how you respond to these so-called gaffes. Same thing with Romney. Gaffes can be instrumental, but only if they play into a larger narrative that is based on our understanding of reality. So the tax returns Bain Capital works only if you say, you know what? That fits in with the narrative that Obama is trying to tell us, which is we got into trouble in the first place because of individuals who exported jobs and basically were vulture capitalists like Mitt Romney. Those are the only gaps that matter. If you do a slip up like Obama saying, you know, we have 51 states, or Romney saying, I don't know what his latest gaffe was. He has one every day, it seems. It doesn't really matter, unless it's part of a larger narrative, right? So I don't want to dismiss the possibility that one of these candidates is going to make a mistake over the next 70 days, but it's probably not going to be as important as the media. And one reason is because campaigns rarely persuade people to change their mind. In 2000, I don't have the data for 2008, but it's similar. 2004, did you ever think you would vote for the other candidate? Bush voters, 16% considered it. Kerry voters, 15% considered it. How many here are who know who they're going to vote for has ever considered voting for the other candidate? Nobody, right? Well, a couple of, possibly, right? Campaigns do not change minds more than they mobilize voters. They give them a reason for voting, but they don't change a lot of minds. All right, a couple other quick factors, and I promise I'll get to the, how are we doing here? A little longer than I wanted. Remember, turnout is crucial. That's why the other thing that campaigns do is they mobilize voters. And interestingly enough, consistently, turnout varies by age. The older you are, and this is, the green here is 2004, this is 2008, this is 2000, and where is, did I do all three of them? Oh, here it is, 96. In each election, this is your age. So from 18, voting age, all the way up, you can see voting increases. This is the turnout of registered voters. This is the turnout of adult age voters. In both cases, so I'm just judging based on, I may be judging wrong, but you're probably among that group is most likely to vote. That's why you're here, right? Because you take an active interest in politics. Interestingly, that may slightly favor Mitt Romney, because polls show that support for Romney actually increases as we go up, generally speaking, controlling for other factors among the older age group, marginally. It looks kind of surprising, but it's true. All right, so the other thing we got to keep in mind is the undecided. Roughly 85 to 90% of voters say they have made up their mind. Of that version, only 10% are likely to change. So here's the number of people who decided how they were going to vote in the last 2 weeks. In 2004, it was only about 15%. There are years when it's much higher, usually like 92, and again in 1980, it's when we have a challenger who they don't know much about. 1980 was the Ronald Reagan debate one, where a lot of people in the end made up their mind, over 25% of voters. 1992, that was Bill Clinton, Ross Perot, and the incumbent. A lot of people didn't know whether they were going to go Perot or Clinton. I don't see that happening in 2012. I think Barack Obama is a well-known quantity. Mitt Romney ran for president in 2008. I suspect it's going to be closer to the 15%. That may help Obama, because he's been leading in the polls by a couple of percentage points. There's not a lot of upside for Romney among undecided voters to really pull ahead, right? because there's just not many undecided voters. Most people have already made up their mind. In fact, I thought I might have this. Roughly 30% of people voted early in 2008. We think that's going to go up to 35% in 2012. Early voting means you actually even have shorter time for the impact of the campaign to change those votes. So it's really a compressed schedule, and I think that makes it harder for the challenger to pick up support. It also puts a premium on get-out-the-vote efforts, and it highlights the importance of the potential enthusiasm gap. I say potential because depending on how you measure it, the Republicans may have a slight advantage relative to 2008 in the enthusiasm among their supporters. They're slightly more enthusiastic, and that's a function of they think they have a better chance of winning. Democrats are a little more worried than they were in 2008 when they pretty much knew their candidate was going to win. So among those absolutely certain to vote, slightly higher number of Republicans. But if you add the probable vote, it's pretty even. Following the presidential race closely, somewhat closely again, pretty even. Enthusiastic about voting, Republicans a slight advantage on the extremely enthusiastic, but when you throw in the very enthusiastic, Democrats are actually ahead. So the enthusiasm level, another way of measuring it is compared to how enthusiastic you were in 2004 and 2008, Green Line's Democrats. Are you more enthusiastic compared to previous elections? You can see Democrats are, compared to previous elections, they're not more enthusiastic. But that doesn't mean you're less enthusiastic. That might just be the same. It's pretty hard to get more enthusiastic than you were in 2008. But Republicans are far more enthusiastic than they were in 2008. So the enthusiasm, we think, may advantage Republicans, but at the margins very slightly. Right? So a lot of this is to get out the vote. And of course, here's your black swan events. I can think of these. I don't know if any of you remember this. George W. Bush was actually leading in the polls. Karl Rove had constructed this wonderful campaign. Al Gore hadn't really maximized the fundamentals. Going into the last week, Bush was ahead. And then someone leaked the fact that he had been arrested for drunk driving. And the evangelical vote just melted. Remember, they didn't know this guy. And a lot of them just did not show up. And he lost 1% to 2% in that last week because of this DUI. So if anybody's got dirt that they've been holding, release it in the last week. It might be a black swan event. We can think of all sorts of things. You might have some of your own. Every time I go in the audience, I really get some creative suggestions from what I've been told. Meteor strikes. All right. Oops, wait, I don't want to show that. All right. You ready? So this is the culmination. Oops, I'm out of the camera. There's a reason for that. I'm going to give my forecast. Now remember, our forecast is of the two-party vote. The share that Obama will get of the two-party vote. It's science here. I'm not imposing my own views on you. I don't vote. I just want to get it right to show you that I have mastered a science. Yes. Okay? You with me?
Yep.
Okay. Here we go. Drum roll? Do you have a drum roll? All right. Look what we have here. This is horrible for my election prediction. This is Obama ahead, ahead, basically a dead heat. Obama to lose, to lose, to lose, to lose. But wait, there's more. Obama ahead, losing. Probably ahead. I've just shown you 11 models. Of those 11 models, 3 forecast Obama to win. 5 forecast Romney to win. 3 are too close to call. Now, keep in mind, this is no less precise than the previous models. That's what I'm saying. I'm basically saying if you add these together, this is about a 50-50 election. Obama is predicted to get 50% of the vote. Dead heat, closest election that I can remember since 2000. Now, all I care about is if Obama gets 50% of the vote, give or take.
You better get out there and vote.
Yeah, but you don't know who I'm going to vote for. You better watch what you say.
I'm in the way, but I think you should.
I know who you're going to vote for.
You do? No.
Very obvious.
It is.
And you should vote because we need you.
Oh, well,
you
don't know you need me. You might not need me. I always kid my students that it's completely irrational to vote.
Thank you.
But I won't go into that. Now, there's a couple of things we have to keep in mind here. So if the election, if he loses the election by 49.5 to 50.5, we were right. If he wins the election by 50.5 to 49.5, we were right. So in a way, we're right either way, whether he wins or loses. But of course, we're not predicting that we're going to get the. You got a question? Sure.
Is that that's just the popular vote.
Just the popular vote.
Not the electoral.
Not the electoral college vote. Now, we do have some models that break down state by state. If you really want to know who wins, Nate Silver's running his forecast models right now. Pay no attention to them. He's making it up. He's not making it up. But his model, the problem we have as political scientists with Nate Silver is he does not. I got him a little food fight with him. I do a blog, and I'll give you the site for that if you want. And he took offense when I basically said, pay no attention to Nate Silver's predictions right now. He wrote a letter he commented to my blog, and so we got a little. And the reason why I don't pay attention to him is because he does not show the inner workings of his model. He just kind of says, trust me. And as a political scientist, one of the things we do is we have a colleague of a community of scholars where we actually are very transparent about what we do. That's how we learn. That's how we figure out what works. He's not showing us his model, so I can't tell you, pay attention to it. But it doesn't matter. If you really want to know who wins this election, wait until 3 or 4 days beforehand. And the polls will be amazingly accurate, much more accurate than our forecast models. Because ultimately, the best predictor of how someone is going to vote is to ask them, how are you going to vote tomorrow? And that's all polls do. And assuming those polls are constructed reliably, if you take averages on a state-by-state level, most states will have enough polls, you can come up with an incredibly accurate prediction, not just of the popular vote, but of the electoral college vote. The problem with that approach is it doesn't tell us why people vote the way they do. And that's what we're really interested in. I don't really care why how you vote. I want to know why you vote. And that's why these models are so important to us, political scientists, because it tells us we understand why you people vote the way you do. A couple of caveats here, and then I'll open up for questions. Polling data is showing Obama with a very slight lead by 1 to 2%. This is within the poll's margin of error. But the fact that he's consistently ahead of every poll is not insignificant. It suggests that he may be running a marginally better campaign. Right? In that framing of the narrative, his argument that Obama is inherited a mess and he needs more time to solve it. And by the way, the reason he had that mess is because of people like Romney. That may be resonating a little bit more than Romney's message, which is the economy is horrible. It's been horrible for 4 years and this man has been in charge. But it's a very close frame, right? The difference in the models, I've been playing with this, I think is, I don't have it. Those models that focus only on the fundamentals tend to be more pessimistic for Obama. Whereas those models that factor in those other factors, how long has Obama been in control of the office, what is his approval ratings, tend to be a little more optimistic. That's the only thing I can see that's differentiating the six models that basically go for Romney. It's basically, what was it?
Five.
Yeah, the five for Romney versus the three for Obama. That's the difference. The Romney ones are just pure fundamentals. They don't include those other factors. What this does here, I don't know if you can read the numbers. In addition to the predicted Obama, this didn't really come out well. This is the vote share. This is the probability of them winning. Certainty of Obama's plurality. So some of these models, like the North Pothkin, it's 88% that Obama's going to win. It just gives you an additional level of precision to estimate the vote share. So again, the models are all over the place. The pure economic ones have him down to 10 to 11% Obama's probability of winning. The ones that have additional factors, this one I wouldn't pay much attention to. That's the one that on January 1st. But this one here includes approval ratings, 80% chance that Obama's going to win. So I'm hedging my bets here by averaging them all together, but there's really a pretty big spread this year among the models. All right, go to it. Questions? Anybody? Have I exhausted you? Yes?
You, in all of the factors you talked about, the one that looks like it might be important this time around, especially in a 50-50 race, is what's happening at the state level in terms of voter eligibility. And I wonder if you'd comment on that.
Yeah, so there, as a lot of you are familiar with, there's efforts in some states to pass voter identification laws, and they're hugely controversial. And they're controversial, it's almost impossible to have a sane discussion of voter identification laws. It's already become so politicized and partisan, with Democrats saying these aren't voter identification laws, these are voter suppression laws, and Republicans saying no. These are consistent with the idea that only citizens should be allowed to vote, and we don't want to have any more fraud like there was with Acorn in 2008, right? Here's the reality. Most voter identification laws are controversial because they impact the parties differently. We know one of the biggest barriers to voting is registration, and it disproportionately impacts people with lower education, lower economic status. Why? Because they do not have the education and the training to know how to, for instance, get an absentee ballot. They often don't have identification because they're not working. The problem is that means it disproportionately affects Democrats. Now, if I asked you, should we let everybody vote, just trust them, you probably would say no. So the principle behind voter identification laws is a legitimate principle. We should be able to discuss that in a reasonable manner about what is the level of criteria that both addresses our needs to make sure only eligible citizens vote, but without disproportionately impacting one set of partisan voters versus the other. The problem is it's very hard to do that. The actual impact of voter identification laws, I think, is overstated in two ways. Republicans say it's going to get a lot of people who normally cheat off the voter rolls, but that's not really going to happen. When you think about it, my wife actually deals with this. She works in town government. And there was a recent story in Vermont about actual voter fraud going on. But you know what kind of voter fraud it was? Absentee ballots. Candidates for office were getting absentee ballots for voters without asking the voters for those absentee ballots. And then they were filling them out and sending them in. Okay. Most of the voter identification laws aren't going to do a thing for that. Right? So the Republicans are overstating the amount of fraud there is out there and the amount that's going to be reduced. On the other hand, my guess, and it's a reasonable guess based on some studies, but it's not something I'd go to the grave with, my guess is the Democrat fear of voter suppression is probably overstated. It's probably, again, in a close Florida-type election that comes down to 500 votes, yeah, it could make the difference. What are the chances that we're going to come down to an election of 500 votes? Historically, it's not very high. So I am cautiously optimistic that this is a fight that really doesn't matter. But I'm not going to go to my grave and saying ignore it. But that's the reason why it's become such a flashpoint, because it does make a difference. Voter identification laws, no matter how well-intentioned, impact likely Democratic voters more than Republican voters, and that's why Democrats are up in arms about it, even if it's legitimate. Yes?
If you have a person that doesn't drive,
yes,
that is of a certain age,
yep,
and they truly want to vote,
yep,
they can't.
Yep, this is the problem, and I hear what you're saying.
It's a big problem, excuse me, in the state of Florida, for example, and there are other sections, I'm sure, in this country that have the same problem.
Right. And listen, and I'm not denying that. And partly, one of the countervailing aspects of this election is the degree to which the Obama campaign is able to use their get-out-the-vote infrastructure. And they, in some ways, by some measures, are far more organized at getting out the vote than the Republicans. So if you look at the number of campaign offices Obama has been able to set up, he's far outnumbering Romney's. He's better funded, in part because he has spent more money earlier to put that infrastructure into play. Whether that will be enough to counteract that type, I don't know. I'm certainly sensitive to that. But we should keep in mind, this is true generally. This is why when you switch from registered voters to likely voters, Republicans do better. Even without voter suppression, lower income, and that means predominantly Democratic voters, do not navigate the voting requirements very well. Or they navigate it proportionally less well than do more affluent, better educated voters who tend to be Republican. There's always a bias here. That was the impetus behind the motor voter registration bill that passed a number of years ago that Republicans opposed. The idea was if you make it easier to register to vote, you're going to disproportionately help Democrats. Turned out it didn't actually work that way. But again, that motor voter registration bill was inherently partisan, even though the intention was good, because Republicans and Democrats thought it was going to impact them differently. They thought Republicans thought it was going to hurt them. Yeah?
Would you care to predict the outcome of the swing states? and do you think there's a possibility that we'll repeat 2000?
The reality here is that, generally speaking, we do not find much discrepancy between the popular vote and the Electoral College vote. So that's why we spend all our time trying to focus on the popular vote. Having said that, it has happened three or four occasions, depending on whether you count the Jackson election. But in previous occasions, there has been instances in which one candidate has won the Electoral College vote and lost the popular vote. It's always possible. If I was going to predict those, the thing I would keep in mind about, okay, I can do this. If I had my map up here, I will show you the swing states. Here are the so-called battleground or swing states. Here's the thing. Again, I want to reiterate my point. They're not independent, right? The national vote is going to influence all these states somewhat equally. Here's what I can tell you. It's going to come down to this state and this state, almost certainly. Here's the other problem. I'm sorry. Ohio and Florida, okay? Because they have the most number of Electoral College votes, and they're running very close. Here's the thing. If you think about the different ways of adding up the Electoral College math, Obama has more ways of putting together a winning coalition than does Romney. But you shouldn't be overconfident about that, because all Romney needs to do is to pick up about 2.5 percentage points from Obama, and suddenly these states all flip pretty much, right? And then the route that Obama has suddenly becomes much narrower. So based right now, I'm cautiously confident that Obama has if not an easier path, he has more paths to reaching 270 than. But you know, this is somewhat dated. I can tell you now, there was a poll out today in North Carolina. I don't know how reliable this, had Romney up 10 percentage points, right? Romney up 10 percentage points. This state, where is it here? Wisconsin has tightened, right? This has been pretty much a dead heat. Colorado has tightened. I don't really see Michigan as a battleground state. I'm pretty comfortable Obama's going to win that. Ohio, Obama has actually maintained a pretty healthy lead there that has not tightened recently. You know, we can play with these projections all you want. If I had more time, I'd put up my trusty map of the United States, and we can go through the different permutations of how to get to 270. Yes? What about the
world market? What about the world market?
Yeah, well, that's one of those. Again, if generally speaking, the incumbent president, fairly or not, is blamed or rewarded for the performance of the economy, if the world market tanks in a way that makes a palpable difference in assessments of voters of the state of the economy in the United States, Obama is going to suffer. He is going to hurt, because it fits the narrative that Romney's trying to make, which is under his stewardship, the economy is not doing well. Keep in mind, that's probably an unfair assessment of the president's ability to maintain economic prosperity. But it didn't stop Obama from claiming credit for creating 4.5 million jobs as well, right? So that's just the nature of the beast. If you're president, you get blamed or rewarded for the economy, and you've got to sort of play the cards that are dealt with you. But yeah, that's one of those black swan events. Yeah.
Last year you mentioned you were surprised by the race in
locations. Yeah.
What about this year?
Race is an important issue. And one, I can show you how important. Raise your hand right now if you're a racist. Funny, I've been asking this question all the way back to 2008. Yeah. And I haven't had a hand go up yet.
You're asking the wrong place.
Well, I'm not casting judgment on anyone. But it gets to a difficulty in assessing race. Because we have to find indirect measures of racism, right? And those measures, because they're indirect, are also imprecise. And this does two things. One is it allows all of us to inject our own personal views. And frankly, most Obama supporters, if he loses this race, are going to say racism was a huge part of it. But I will say this, without trying to squash that idea, our forecast models in 2008 almost nailed his popular vote. And I didn't have a variable for race. I treated him the way I treated white candidates. Now, that doesn't mean race didn't factor into play. What could have happened is race may have counteracted each other. Keep in mind, a recent Pew poll, this is pretty astounding when you think about it, and I'm going to ask you if you think this is racism. Among African Americans, and that constitute roughly 12% of the population, they turn out slightly more than that in the election. They polled African Americans. How many African Americans in this Pew poll, which is a random sample of the country at large, were going to vote for Mitt Romney? Is that racism? I don't know if it is or not, but the point is racism cuts both ways. In fact, in the initial results after 2008, colleagues of mine did a study and concluded that race mattered in 2008 and benefited Barack Obama. The argument was he did slightly better among white voters than did John Kerry. John Kerry won about 40% of white voters. Obama won 43%, so he increased support among white voters. And had a huge increase in support among not just African Americans. Typically, African Americans vote Democrat 89 to 91%. He won 98% of African Americans, but also among Latinos. Latino support actually had been trending Republican under George Bush, reversed itself in 2008. I didn't necessarily agree with my colleagues because I thought that that white vote was misleading. It said, yeah, he got more than Kerry, but if he was white, how much more would he have gotten? Hard to tell. But I am an agnostic on the race issue. I think race matters. It's hard to measure, but we have to keep in mind that it cuts both ways, right? And we can play, actually one of the more sophisticated studies of race showed, it, and again, this is a sort of political scientist, we have to play with the, you know, the what if. Basically, we're arguing this. If we could redo this election, but change the color of Barack Obama's skin to white, what difference would that make in the election? The closest we were able to come in 2008 in the Democratic primary, we estimated the vote totals of Hillary Clinton versus Barack Obama and tried to control. And we think race by itself may have cost Obama about 1% of the vote among Democrats in the primary. So all along the way, I'm not trying to dodge you. I think race matters at the margins. It may be influential in a close election. But it is not the case, I do not believe, that race in and of itself will cost Barack Obama the election in 2012, in part because it didn't seem to affect his overall total in 2008. I'm a data-driven guy.
What about the accusations of, you know, being a Muslim?
You know, it is amazing how many people, when you ask, is he a Muslim, say yes, right? And that's disproportionately among Republicans, right? Polling is very tricky business. Here's the thing. There is a response bias built into any poll. If you are asked about something, most Americans assume you're being asked for a reason. And so there is a tendency to want to agree with the polling question. So depending on how you ask that question, you're actually going to encourage people to say, yes, he's a Muslim. I think that probably overstates. A lot of people are unsure what he is. They remember some controversy with some Reverend Wright who was screaming about Damn America. They remember he was in, wasn't he even born in, where was he born? They're not sure. But he spent some time in Indonesia. He went to some Muslim elementary school or something. They're unsure. A lot of Americans are unsure. They don't really pay that much attention, frankly. And if a question comes to them that says, do you believe Barack Obama is a Muslim? Certain people are going to say, geez, they're asking me to be a Muslim. He must be. Right? So you've got to be very careful about extrapolating. There was a recent question that asked, who was more responsible for killing Osama bin Laden, Mitt Romney or Barack Obama? About 20% of the voters said Mitt Romney. And everyone said, yeah, people are stupid. Well, you know, what do you mean by responsible? I mean, Barack Obama basically inherited George Bush's war on terror. He's just doing it more. You know, Mitt Romney was sort of a Republican along with Barack George Bush. He's been harder on foreign policy. You can weave all sorts of scenarios to explain why someone is just not going to give Barack Obama credit. We shouldn't read too much into those polls. I think most people really know that Barack Obama ordered the killing of Osama bin Laden. But so polls are, for instance, one of the big issues that always comes up, and I haven't dealt with anything, is abortion. Right? If you watch the Democratic Convention, you think abortion is the issue. I mean, they ran out woman speaker after woman speaker on the abortion issue. What they don't say is, who supports abortion rights in this country more, men or women? Men do. Historically, that's been true for the longest time. Slightly more men support freedom of choice than do women. Moreover, very few people view abortion as a major issue. And you say, how can that be? Because when you ask them about abortion, do you think it's an important issue? People say, yes, it is. But that's because you're asking them about it. If you actually ask people, list the top five issues facing this country, and don't cue them at all, about 1% of people mention abortion. About 1% mention gay rights. About 1% mention gun control. All those hot-button social issues that MSNBC and Fox are fighting over, most voters don't care. 89% say the economy or the budget deficit is the most important issue in this election. The next highest thing is health care. That's what this election is about. You should not be deceived when you see pundits screaming about the abortion or the social values issues or the cultural divide, red state, blue state. It's not a driving force in this election. And we can largely ignore that in our forecast models. Yes?
I have a question.
Sure.
I was not born in this country, but in Europe. Why do you have an electoral poll on college against the popular vote? The rest of the world is all popular vote.
Yeah. It's a legacy of the founding. When we created this country, there was deep distrust among the framers. Remember, this is before the internet, before interstate highway, before the telephone, the telegraph. George Washington, our first president, once went on an inspection tour, and he was out of touch with everybody for 6 weeks. He was in the wilderness somewhere, lost in Virginia or something. The framers were very suspicious about people's ability to know anything about any candidate outside their own village. And so they really thought we should allow the people some participation. And a lot of us don't know how the Electoral College works. Technically speaking, the members of the Electoral College still select our president. And if they ever wanted to autonomously decide to select Matt Dickinson as president, me, even though I haven't run, and I get 270 votes in the Electoral College, I am president of the United States, whether you like it or not, assuming I meet eligibility requirements. Now, very soon in our history, the electors, the individual electors, began pledging themselves to party candidates beforehand, and that's how they are today. But the original idea here was we wanted to allow voters indirect participation. So very early in our, basically under the Constitution, the states are allowed to allocate or select electors by any means they want. And in the first elections, several states said, well, each party's electors would be based on popular vote. Many of them were appointed by state legislatures. In other words, there was some mechanism for popular participation. But then once the electors were selected, the idea was they were going to be like a, you know, a college of cardinals, electing the Pope. They were going to be independent people. They were going to use their best judgment. Why? Because they were the wisest among us. That is the argument. Because the rank and file, Joe Sixpack, or I guess in his day would be Joe Alehouse, right? Joe the blacksmith, didn't know enough about politics to actually make that final decision. So that's the system we've come up with. And it has certain biases. It rewards smaller states, smaller states are overrepresented in the Electoral College, so it's been very hard to change that. Interestingly enough, has anyone heard about the National Popular Vote Movement?
No.
You should, because Vermont has signed on to it. Mm-hmm. There is a means of subverting, changing the Constitution without actually amending it. And the way the system works now is, in each state, we allocate our Electoral College votes. In Vermont, there's three Electoral College votes based on two senators, one representative. Whoever gets the most votes in the state of Vermont gets all three Electoral College votes, right? Each state does that, mm-hmm. with the exception of Maine and Nebraska, who can split them. Under this legislation that is being adopted by a state-by-state basis, so far 9 states have adopted it, including Vermont, states pledge not to award their Electoral College votes to the person who wins their popular vote. Instead, they are going to award their Electoral College votes to whoever wins the popular vote nationwide. Vermont has signed into this. That law will go into effect as soon as enough states that total 270 Electoral College votes have signed on. That could be as little as 15 to 18 states,
who
if they're big enough. State legislature, your good governor, Peter Shumlin.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, really?
They are subverting, they are changing the Constitution, our mechanism to make us more like European nations, without actually amending the Constitution.
And how many states have signed up?
9 have signed. Interestingly enough, do you think...
How many electoral votes do they have?
They only have, less than 100 right now. So they're not there. Interestingly enough, do you think these are large urban states, mostly, that do this?
No.
Actually, they are. They're large urban states. And do you know why that is? Think about it. Democrats are disadvantaged under the Electoral College because their voters are concentrated in large urban areas. Whereas if you look at the actual, if I had my red state, blue state up here, and look at the number of states that Democrats win, they're really isolated. Democrats tend to win the left coast, right? California, Oregon, Washington. No pun intended, in New England. And they, if they're lucky, they can steal a couple of those Midwest states, Pennsylvania. Republicans own the map. There's just nobody out there in Wyoming or Idaho or Utah, right? So the Electoral College actually is slightly biased towards smaller states, and smaller states tend to be dominated by Republicans. So all the states who have signed on to this are Democratic-leaning states. And most of them, with the exception of Vermont, are large urban areas because they think they're going to be advantaged. And so you can see the implications of this. If this passes, then the Constitution hasn't been amended. The Electoral College is basically done away with, even though it's still there on the books, as long as the electors follow the state mandate to vote for whoever wins the popular vote, we'd have what you think is the more reasonable way. But it's really kind of a strange way to change our electoral system. Most people don't know what's happening. There hasn't been a debate about this. I'm kind of uneasy about it, because I think we should have a debate about it. And you could see how it's going to change how candidates run for office. They'd focus on the urban areas, where all the votes are. Your Democrats are going to do better. Policy is going to change. That has huge ramifications for the direction of this nation. It really should be debated more than it is. Yes?
Could I just, we need to wrap up quickly, so one more question.
One more question.
Yeah.
I'm glad to talk afterwards.
Do you actually have a model?
Do I have a model?
Yeah.
I'm working on a model.
What you showed us were the averages of everybody else's.
Yeah, my model is.
And if you have a model, do you actually have a prediction?
I'm working on it. What's that?
You promised us.
Well, I haven't. I promised you that I would tell you the outcome of the popular vote. I did. You didn't listen carefully, Joey. I do have a very crude model, which is based on an average of those that I then adjust for a couple additional factors. And I will. So here, let me finish up here. My blog, I post my prediction on my blog. My blog is Presidential Power. If you Google my last name, Dickinson, D-I-C-K-I-N-S-O-N, I really should have it up here. Why I don't do this. And Presidential Power, it'll bring you to my blog.
Dickinson,
D-I-C-K-I-N-S-O-N, and Presidential Power. Google that. It'll bring you to my blog. I post almost daily. If you want to be on the notification list. I have a huge email notification list whenever I post a new, I send it out to people's email. Give me your email address and I will add it. Nobody ever sees your email address. It's never posted visibly. I just blind CC it. I will notify you when I post my prediction. I don't have a prediction yet because I taught alumni, I taught alumni college 2 weeks ago. I am now the departmental chair. Classes started yesterday, or actually 2 weeks ago. So that's my excuse. I haven't gotten to it yet.
Okay.
But I promise I will have a prediction. You can roast me. If I'm wrong, I will come back here. And you can publicly embarrass me because I'm now on television. Thank you very much.